Am I audible? Write in the question pane so that I can come to know that whether I am audible or not. Okay. Fine. So slides are also visible. If somehow some students are not able to see the sound, you can just refresh your settings, then you'll be able to see, right? Okay, so let's begin with. So let me introduce myself. I'm Dr. Tanya Bose, Associate Professor in Department of Applied Sciences. So I will be teaching you about functions of complex variables, right? Now, before I tell you about what all is there in today's presentation, there is a very important announcement for you all. The announcement is that FA2 of the subject, that is differential equations and transformations, or EM2, it will be conducted tomorrow, that is 13th May, from 5:30 p.m. to 6 p.m., right? You will be provided with the link to join it, and then you can do your test. It will be MCQ-based, and the syllabus of FA2 would be the entire partial differential equations and wave equation. Clear? Okay. So let me begin with today's session. Now, in my today's session, I will be talking about the introduction of this chapter, complex variables, then limit, continuity, and differentiability. Right? Okay. Now, let me start with the first topic, that is about complex variables. What is this topic all about, right? Now, I think you can see this chart, which tells me about the birth of all the number systems that exist till now. So just quickly revising it, we can see that first of all, the natural numbers came and the numbers started from 1, 2, 3 and so on. But then when we were subtracting the same number, the answer 0 was not there. So that number was invented and it was classified as whole numbers, right? So natural numbers plus 0 became the whole number system. Then in whole numbers, where did the problem lie? When a smaller number was subtracted from a higher number, the answer was coming out to be negative. So there were no negative numbers present in the whole number system. So when the negative numbers came into being, they were grouped as integers, right? And then rational numbers came, irrational numbers came, and this whole number system was classified as real numbers, right? So the real numbers came into being. Then what happened? The mathematicians were trying to solve equations of the type x squared plus 1, these type of equations. And when these quadratic equations were solved, there was no answer to discriminant of a negative number, right? So there was no answer to under root of minus 1. So there, the concept of complex numbers came into being. So this under root of minus 1 was termed as iota, or it was termed as an imaginary number. So the number systems were given a new name and it were classified as A plus B iota, where A was the real part of the number and B was the imaginary part of the number. So this number system was called as the complex numbers that we have already started in plus 2 or plus 1, right? Now, our topic is complex functions. So what are complex functions now? Let's see which mathematicians were behind the theory of complex variables. The theory of the functions of complex variables, it is one of the beautiful as well as a useful branch of mathematics. Although originating in an atmosphere of mystery, suspicion and distrust, as evidenced by the terms imaginary and complex present in the literature, it was finally placed on a sound foundation in the 19th century through the efforts of Cauchy, Riemann, Weierstrass, Gauss, and many other great mathematicians, right? Now, let us see what are the applications of this subject, right? So we find that complex analysis, it is used in analog electronic design. The filters are classified by singularities of a complex transfer function. Impedance is modeled as a complex value in AC circuits such as audio amplifiers. Then the wave function of quantum mechanics and quantum field theory, this is also complex valued. It was used to conceive and design the transistor, without which our digital devices would still require a large room and a lot of power and have very little memory. Then, these days, complex analysis is also used in neuroscience and economics. So in mechanical design, complex variables, they allow polynomial equations to be solved that would otherwise be unsolvable. Complex analysis, it is also used to solve certain real value definite integrals, which we are not able to solve in our previous classes, right? So that is solved with the help of residue systems. Finally, the notion of conformal mapping is of fundamental importance in complex analysis. Many real life applications of conformal maps, they include cartography, airplane wing design, and many other applications. So the conformal maps, they are used by mathematicians, physicists, and engineers to change the regions with complicated shapes into much simpler ones, and to do so in a way that preserves shapes on a small scale, right? So we see that complex analysis is such a beautiful subject and it has so many applications. Now let's see what is this subject all about. So you should know what are the basics of these subjects, right? So continuing with it, let's see what are functions of complex variables. We have studied what are complex numbers. Now what are functions of complex variables? So if I define a complex variable, I will define it as z is equal to x plus iota y, where x and y, they are real variables, and z will be called a complex variable. So x is the real part of the complex variable and y is the imaginary part of the complex variable. Now, any function that is defined on this z, that means if I define f of z, I'm defining a function on this z, then obviously that function will also have some real part and imaginary part. So the real part is being classified as u, and the imaginary part is being classified as v. So, and the notation will be followed throughout this chapter. We will call fz is equal to w. So whenever we will talk about a complex function, we will say that w is equal to f of z, and it will be characterized into real and imaginary part as u plus iota v. That means for every value of x comma y in z, there will be a corresponding value of u comma v in the value of w, right? So if I have any plot for x and y, if I plot this value in this function, I will get a corresponding value for u and v, right? Okay. I hope it is clear. Okay, one of the students is asking me that, ma'am, are these applications going to be asked in MCQ? No, don't worry. These applications will not be asked in MCQs, but you should know that why is this subject important for you, right? So that is why I'm telling you about the applications. Okay. Now moving ahead, let us see this meaning of functions graphically. Now I was telling you that w is equal to f of z. That means if I plug in some value of z, what is my z? Z is a complex variable. It is x plus iota y. So if I plot this graphically, this is my point x and this is y. So this point will refer to x comma y, right? So corresponding to this value of z, what will happen? This is called the z plane, where I'm plotting the point x and y. I will get a corresponding plane, which is called the w plane, where this point z will be mapped to the point w. So this is the value of my function f of z, and it will give me the value u plus iota v. That means this plane is talking about the complex variable and this plane is talking about the complex function. So you must be thinking that why am I drawing two graphs? Because there are four variables involved. So I cannot pictorially define all the four variables all together in one graph. So that is why in one graph, I'm plotting the values of x and y. And the second graph, that is the W plane, is telling me about the function, that is W. Right? So there is the Z plane and there is a W plane. So the Z plane tells me about the variable, the complex variable, and the W plane tells me about the function. So the standard notations followed will be for complex variable throughout the chapter, we will use the notation Z and it will always represent X plus iota Y. And the complex function, it will be denoted by W or F of Z and it will be characterized as U plus iota V. I hope it is clear. Okay. Yes, it is also called the Argand plane. Yes, very good. It is called the Argand plane, right? Okay. Fine. Now, this is a small exercise based on the concept that we have just done. You can see that there is a function given to you. Let W is equal to F of Z is Z squared plus 3Z. You need to find out the values of U and V. That means for this function, the question tells you to ask, you need to find out the real part of that function and the imaginary part of the function. So how do we solve it? We have W is equal to Z squared plus 3Z and I know that the value of Z is X plus iota Y. So I will just plug in Z as X plus iota Y. So I will square it up plus 3 times Z will be written as X plus iota Y. When you solve this, if you open up the squares, you will get A squared plus B squared. B squared will be iota squared Y squared. Iota squared is minus 1. So you'll get a minus Y squared here. Then plus 2 into x into iota y, that is iota times 2xy, plus, open up this brackets, you'll get 3x plus iota times 3y. Now, when you group in the real part and the imaginary part, the real part is x squared minus y squared. This is the imaginary part, so we will leave this term. And then the next real part is 3x. So I have grouped them in one bracket, so this is my real part. And then the terms which are containing iota, these are the imaginary terms. So I'm writing iota and then we have 2xy plus 3y. So if you compare it with u plus iota v, u is the real part, that is minus y squared plus 3x. And the imaginary part, v is 2xy plus 3y. So I think this example is very simple and it is very clear to all of you that how to classify the real part and imaginary part from a function. Okay. Fine. Any doubt so far? I already answered that is called an Argand plane. Okay. Any questions still here? Anything which is not clear? Okay, fine. So let me proceed further. So now we move on. So I gave you the introduction of complex functions. Now we move on with the next topic, that is limit, the second section of my presentation today. Now, what is limit? Let's recall the definition of limit that we have done earlier. What is limit at a point? Look at this graph. The graph makes it very clear that there is a function fx and I want to calculate the limit of this function at the point 2, right? So you can see there are two arrows marked here, right? So what is the meaning of these two arrows? This arrow tells me about the left-hand limit and the second arrow tells me about the right-hand limit. That means what is the concept of limit at a point? To calculate the limit of the function at the point x equal to 2, since it is just a point, so I am in 1D, so I can approach this point either from the left side or from the right side only. There is only one point, there is only one plane, right? This is the plane and 2 is here. So I can approach the point either from the left or from the right. And so we calculate the left-hand limit and the right-hand limit. So if both the limit values, they match each other, we say that the limit of the function exists at that particular point, right? So this is the concept of limit that you do in reals. Now let's see What is the definition of limit, or what is the concept of limit of a complex function? Now, in a complex function, we are dealing with the point a plus iota b. Suppose I want to calculate the limit of a function fz at the point a plus iota b. So you can see there will be an x-axis and there will be an y-axis. So the point, suppose it lies somewhere here. Now, how many ways are there to reach this particular point? Is there only left and right approach? Do you think so? No. There are numerous ways to approach this point. You can approach this point through a straight line, that is y equal to mx, isn't it? If I just draw a straight line like this, I can approach this point. And then you can keep different values of m. I can write it as y equal to 1x, 2x, 3x, and so, which will satisfy this particular point. And I will get numerous straight lines which can be passing through this point a plus iota b. Then I can also approach this particular point through a quadratic equation. That means an equation of degree 2. So I can draw a curve. I can make like this y equal to mx squared. Likewise, I can also approach this particular point through a cubic equation, through a fourth degree equation, through a fifth degree equation, and continuing in this way, I can approach this point with a nth degree equation. That means I can follow any path in 2D to approach this particular point. That means, what is the definition of limit then in complex function? That means, if along all these paths the limit values are same, only then we will say that the limit of a complex function, it will be existing, right? In real variables, we were only talking about the left and the right approach. So if the limit values there were equal, only then we say that the limit exists. So here, if I'm able to approach this point through all these paths, then I will only say that the limit will exist at this particular point if limit along all these paths are equal and they exist, right? But then the question is, how many paths will I check in the question? That means one question will take such a long time. So let's see how to approach the questions. How will you come to know that how the limit exists in which questions, right? So let's see the examples. Look at the first example. Find the following limit. Limit z approaches to 2 plus iota z squared minus 4z plus 2 plus 5 iota. So you can see that this is a polynomial function, right? So for polynomial functions, it is the simplest question. You simply have to put down the value of z in the question. That's it. You follow any path, you will get the same answer along all the paths, provided it is a polynomial function, right? So let's see the solution of this question. So I have to substitute z equal to 2 plus iota in the quadratic equation. So I will simply substitute wherever I have z, I will substitute it as 2 plus iota. So I get 2 plus iota squared minus 4 into 2 plus iota plus 2 plus 5 iota. And when I solve this equation, I get my answer as minus 3 plus 5 iota. So the limit of this function will be minus 3 plus 5 iota. Now, many of you might be having a doubt in your minds that in the previous slide, I was talking about so many paths. And now here, when I'm calculating the limit, I'm simply putting the value of the limit, right? So you will get it clear in the next slides, right? I'll again come back to this slide and I'll tell you why did I substitute z equal to 2 plus iota here directly, right? Let's see the next question. Find the following limit. The question is, find limit of z approaches to 1, z squared minus 1 upon z minus 1. So I can see this is a simple question like you do in plus 2 level. I'm just factorizing my numerator. So I get z minus 1 into z plus 1. So I can see that z minus 1 will get cancelled. So the only function left is z plus 1. And then I have to take the limit as z approaches to 1. So when I put z equal to 1, the limit value is 2. So here also you can see that this question was reduced to z plus 1 And this is again a polynomial function. So I have simply put the value of z in this to get the value of the limit, right? Okay. Now, let me check the next question. And let me see, will the concept always remain the same like this only, or will it change? Look at example number three. Look at this question. Limit z approaches to z, sorry, limit z approaches to 2 iota 3x plus iota y square. So in the previous question, you can see that the function was also in terms of z. So we were simply putting down the value of z in the question, right? Now the function is in terms of x and y. That means the limit should also be in terms of x and y. So let's quickly calculate the values where will x and y approach. So we know that standard notation z is equal to x plus iota y. Z is approaching to 2 iota, so I substitute z as 2 iota. So when I compare both sides, I will get x is equal to 0 and y is equal to 2, right? So if z is approaching to 2 iota, that means x is approaching to 0 and y is approaching to 2. Now, again, you can see that this is a polynomial function. So calculating the limit of this function is same as calculating the limit of the function at x approaching to 0 and y approaching to 2. So what am I doing? I'm simply putting x 0 here and y 2 here. So this term turns out to be 0 and I get iota into 2 squared, that is 4 iota, right? So in all these three examples, whether the function is in terms of z or it is in terms of x and y, they were all polynomial functions. So I was simply substituting whatever the z was approaching to. I was putting that value in the function and that was my answer to the limit value, right? Okay. Now, let's move on to the next question and see what is there. Look at the next question. Example number four. Now here the question statement changes. The question says, show that the following limit do not exist. Let's see, when will the limit not exist? And the function is, you have to check the limit of z approaching to 0, z upon mod z. So you can clearly see that this is not a polynomial function. So I cannot directly substitute z equal to 0 in the numerator and denominator. That means, what is the methodology followed here? Okay. Let's see. First of all, since it is mod z, and I know that z is equal to x plus iota y, so what will be modulus of z? It is under root of x squared plus y squared. That means I have to convert my function, first of all, in terms of x and y. For that reason, I have to also convert the value of z here. So if z is approaching to 0, that means x plus iota y is also approaching to 0. So if I compare both sides, I will get x is equal to 0 and y is equal to 0, right? So if z is approaching to 0, this implies x is approaching to 0 and y is also approaching to 0. Now let's look at the function. So you can see that I have written the function z as x plus iota y and I have written mod z as under root of x square plus y square. Now, whenever the question is that limit does not exist or you need to check the limit of a function, we will go back to the definition of limit that we did for complex functions. And I told you that you have to check down the limit values for all the paths. Now, how many paths you have to consider? So what is your first path? Now, when I say that x is approaching to 0 and y is approaching to 0, that means I'm talking about two paths here. What are those two paths? The first path can be y approaching to 0 followed by x approaching to 0. Whenever you do questions on limits of complex functions, you never substitute two limits together. You will not together substitute x and y equal to 0. We will do it one by one. So one by one means either you will first put y approaching to 0 and then x approaching to 0, or you will put first x approaching to 0 and then y approaching to 0. And hence, you will get two different paths from there, right? So we choose the first path. The first path is we will first take y approaching to 0 followed by x approaching to 0. So look at the question statement. We have limit z approaching to 0, z upon mod z. So I'm taking the first limit as y approaching to 0 in this. Whatever answer I'll get here, then I'll substitute the limit x approaching to 0. So when I put y approaching to 0, what will happen? This will become 0. This will become 0. So I am left with x upon under root of x square, right? So this is my answer left. Limit x approaches to 0, x upon mod under root of x square. Now, limit x approaches to 0, x upon, what is under root of x square? Under root of x square will be mod of x, because I may get plus x or minus x. So I will write here mod x. Now, what is x upon mod x? If your mod x is positive, it will be x written here. Both the terms will get cancelled and you will get plus 1. And if mod x is negative, then you will get x upon minus x. X and x will get cancelled and your limit value will be minus 1. That means depending on mod x, your answer will be either plus 1 or minus 1, right? That means for the rest of the paths also, I should get the same answer, right? Let's check the next path. Now, the next path, as told to you, the next path is we will first take x approaching to 0 followed by y approaching to 0. Here, what did I do? I took y approaching to 0 first and then I took x approaching to 0. Now, I'm taking x approaching to 0 first followed by y approaching to 0, just the opposite of the previous step. So now when I take x approaching to 0, these two terms will become 0. What am I left with? I will be left with limit y approaching to 0, iota y upon under root of y square, right? Now, again the same concept, under root of y square can be plus or minus y, depending upon whatever answer you get to the square root. So I write it as mod of y. Similarly, so if this mod y is positive y, I will get my answer as plus iota. And if this mod y is negative y, I will get my answer as minus iota. So you can see that from the first part, I was getting my answer as plus minus 1. And when I followed the second part, my answer changed. I got plus minus iota, right? So are the limit values along all the paths same? I don't have to check for the rest of the paths. It is only conflicting here only when I'm reaching the second path. So what does it show? It shows that as it approaches to 0 along two different paths, we obtain two different limits and therefore the limit does not exist. Limit is always a unique value. So the limit along all the paths must be same. And hence, the limit of this particular function does not exist, right? Okay. Let me quickly go through the questions that you have written. Y under root x square plus y square. Okay. It is not written here as mod. It is mod z. What is mod z? It is modulus of z. Quickly brush up your concept of complex. What is mod of z? It is under root of square root of x square plus y square. It is under root of real part square plus imaginary part square. If it was simply z written here, then I will write it as x plus iota y. It is mod z written here, right? I hope I'm clear. Okay. Then, one of the students is writing that in example 4, if we write left hand limit and right hand limit, there is no concept of left hand limit and right hand limit in complex functions that only exist in case of real numbers, right? So there is no concept because you are in an Argand plane, you are in a Z plane. So the point is in 2D. So you cannot approach that point from left and right. You can approach that point from numerous paths. So there is no concept of left hand limit and right hand limit, right? I'll just explain these questions once again so that it becomes clear. The concept of limit, and I'm again repeating, when you do the concept of limits in real numbers, you are only on one dimension. That means you are only in the number line. So on the number line, you can approach a particular point either from the left or from the right direction. There is no other way, right? But when we are in the complex plane, that means when you are in the Z plane, you can approach that point through different paths, either from a straight line, from a quadratic equation, through a cubic path, through a bi-quadratic path, or any degree, right? So whenever we have to check that the limit of a function, whether it exists or whether it does not exist, we have to check the limit along all the paths. And we have to make it ensure that the limit along all the paths should become equal. If along any one of the paths, the limit value is not equal, there and there only we can declare that the limit of that function does not exist. And how to check for those paths? The first path always comes from the limit value. So you can see that, first of all, z is approaching to zero. I told you that this is not a polynomial function. I cannot directly substitute 0 by mod 0. First of all, it is not defined, right? So I cannot directly substitute. If and only if it is a polynomial function, that means the denominator is 1. Only there, like we did in the previous examples, I can directly substitute the value of the function, the value of z that is given to me. But in this particular question, I cannot directly substitute because it is not defined, right? So for these questions, I have to first of all convert the function in terms of x and y, and then according to the suitable paths, I have to check the values of the limit. So to choose the paths, z is approaching to 0 means, what is z? Z is x plus iota y, so I'm putting it equal to 0. So when I compare both sides, I will get x is equal to 0 and y is equal to 0, right? So x, and I'm again repeating the same point, that we cannot substitute both these values together. We have to substitute it one by one, right? So one by one, it means that either I will first substitute x approaching to 0, and then I will substitute y approaching to 0, or I will first substitute y approaching to 0, and then I will substitute x approaching to 0. And hence, I get two different paths from here. So when I check around the first path, that means I'm first substituting y approaches to 0. So when I put y approaches to 0, let me substitute here. The function left is x upon under root x squared. And when you solve this part, you get your limit value as plus minus 1. Now, when I check first x approaching to 0 and then y approaching to 0, the limit value turns out to be plus minus iota. That means along the first path, the value is plus minus 1. Along the second path, the value is plus minus iota. That means along these two different paths, the limit values are different. And hence, the limit of this particular function will not exist, right? Don't worry, there are many examples. So with the flow, you will get to know how to do these questions, right? Okay. So I think I've already told y mod of z is under root of x squared plus y squared. Okay, fine. Yeah, okay. Let me move on to the next example. The next example says, show that the following limit do not exist. Look at the function. Limit z approaches to 0, real part of z minus imaginary part of z whole square divided by mod z whole square. So again, you can see it is not a polynomial function. There is something in the denominator, and when z is approaching to 0, I cannot substitute 0 here, otherwise it will be not defined, right? So I have to convert this function in terms of x and y, and I have to check the limit along the different paths, right? So let us see. So again, the same concept, z approaches to 0 means I will substitute z as x plus iota y equal to 0. And when I compare the real and the imaginary paths, I get x is approaching to 0 and y is approaching to 0. So the first two paths that I get is I can first put x approaching to 0 and then I can put y approaching to 0, or I can first put y approaching to 0 and then x approaching to 0. So let's see. Now before I start with the solution, what is real part of z? If z is x plus iota y, real part of z is x. And what is imaginary part of z? Imaginary part of z is y. So this function can be written as x minus y whole squared divided by, again, what is modulus of z? Modulus of z is under root of x squared plus y squared. And when you square it up, you will simply get x squared plus y squared in the denominator, right? Now let's check out the limits. So limit z approaches to 0, real part of z minus imaginary part of z whole squared divided by mod z square is equal to, the path is, first I will put y approaching to 0 and then I follow it as x approaching to 0. So I've converted my function in terms of x and y as explained just now. Now let me put y approaching to 0. When I put y approaching to 0, this term will become 0 and this term will become 0. So what is left? I am left with x minus 0 square, which is x square, and in the denominator I am left with x square. So I can see that x square and x square gets cancelled. What is left? The limit value is 1. That means along rest of the paths the limit value should be 1. If it is 1, then the limit will exist. If it is not 1, then the limit will not exist. So let me check the second path. Now in the second path we are taking x approaches to 0 followed by y approaches to 0. So you can see here, when I put x approaching to 0, these terms will become 0 and I'm left with minus y whole square, which is y square divided by y square. So again this will get cancelled and my answer is 1. That means along the first path the limit value is 1, along the second path the limit value is 1. But I cannot conclude my answer here because I haven't checked for the rest of the paths. These are only two paths, and I told you in that pictorial diagram that there can be many paths, right? So these were two paths directly that we were getting from the points. Now what can be the next path? If you remember the diagram, I told you that you can approach that particular point through straight lines also, right? And what is the equation of the straight line? Y is equal to mx. So let us choose the next path as y is equal to mx. So when you choose y equal to mx, you should take care that this point 0 comma 0 should satisfy your path, right? So if I put x equal to 0 and y equal to 0, both the sides are 0 and hence the path is satisfied. So I have to choose the straight line y equal to mx. Now when I choose y equal to mx, that means I'm giving some value to y. That means my entire function will be now converted in terms of the variable x. So only the limit value of x will be left. So I write limit x approaching to 0, x minus y whole square divided by x square plus y square. So when I put y is equal to mx, when you substitute here, I will get m square mx, and I can take out x common from here. So x square will come out. And I will be left with 1 minus m whole square in the brackets. And from the denominator, when I put y is equal to mx, I can write here m square x square. So again, x square will come out common and I will be left with 1 plus m square, right? So x square will get cancelled from the numerator and denominator. And the limit value left is 1 minus m whole square upon 1 plus m square. Now you can see that by putting different values of m, if I put m as 1, what will be my answer? 1 minus 1 whole square divided by 1 plus 1 square. If I put m equal to 2, I will get 1 minus 2 whole square upon 1 plus 2 square. So is it coming equal to 1? No, it is not coming equal to 1. That means for different values of m, we will get different values of limit value from here, right? So what does it show? That along different paths, the limit are not unique and hence the limit does not exist. Now suppose here also if I get 1, then what will I do? I will check the next path. the next part will be y equal to mx square, right? So, but now, obviously, if you're doing attempting it in the MCQ, you will not get such a long question that you are checking for indefinite paths. For one or two paths only, you will conclude your answer that whether your limit will exist or whether it will not exist, right? So you can see that whenever we have to check for different, the limit, the concept of limit, the concept of path is mandatory. You have to check along different paths and then you have to conclude your answer. So if the limit value is different in the second path only, you can conclude your answer there. Suppose like in this question, it was not same. So we moved on to the next one. So if this was not, if this is different, so I'm concluding my answer as limit is not existing. Otherwise, I will go to the next step and I will check for the next path, right? Okay. Now, what are the properties of limit? I told you that limit is always a unique value. If for a function fz, the limit is L, and or equal to m, that means Am I audible? Point. Now, a function fx is said to be continuous at a point x if these three conditions are satisfied. What are these three conditions? First of all, the value of the function at that point should exist. The limit where we are calculating the limit value for that function, it should exist. That means in real numbers, the right-hand limit and the left-hand limit should exist. And then finally, the limit value of fx, it should be equal to the value of the function at the given point. That means for continuity, the limit value of fx should be equal to f of a, right? So for continuity, we need to have three steps. First of all, fa should exist. The limit value should exist. That means the left-hand limit and right-hand limit must match each other. And the limit value of the function should be equal to f of a. Let us check what is there in the definition of continuity of a complex function. Now, when it is same as the definition is same as we did in real numbers, a complex function fz is continuous at a point z0 if all three of the following statements are true. The first statement says limit z approaches to z0, f of z should exist. F of z0, it should exist. And thirdly, limit of fz as z approaches to z naught, it should be equal to f of z. That means the limit of the function should exist. The point where we are calculating the value of the function, it should exist. And these two values should be equal to each other, right? So now let's look at the examples. Look at this question. You are given a function f of z equal to z squared plus 4 upon z minus 2 iota, where z is not equal to 2 iota. And if z is equal to 2 iota, the value of the function is 3 plus 4 iota. So the first question says, what is the value of the limit of fz as z approaches to 2 iota? Right? So how to calculate the limit? So you can easily see that I can write z squared plus 4 as, I can factorize it as z minus 2 iota into z plus 2 iota. And then I can see that these two terms cancel and I'm left with a polynomial function, that is z plus 2 iota. There is nothing in the denominator. So I can simply substitute z as 2 iota and I get my answer as 4 iota, right? So this is the limit of my function as z approaches to 2 iota. Let's look at the second question. What is the value of fz at z equal to 2 iota? Go to the question. What is the value of fz at z equal to 2 iota? It is given 3 plus 4 iota, right? So what is the value of fz at z equal to 2 iota? It is 3 plus 4 iota, right? Now, for the function to be continuous, the limit value should be equal to the value of the function at z equal to 2 iota. Is it so? Is 4 iota equal to 3 plus 4 iota? No, the values are not equal. And hence, the limit, the function is not continuous, right? So the third question said that is fz continuous at z equal to 2 iota? No, because the value of the limit and the value of the function at that point, they are not equal to each other. If this was also 4 iota, then it will be continuous, right? Okay, fine. Now, let's look at the MCQ question now. The question says, for the function f of z is defined as imaginary part of z upon mod z, where z is not equal to 0 and it is equal to 0 when z is equal to 0, right? So you have to mark the correct option, whether the limit of fz at z equal to 0 exists, whether f of z is not equal to 0, whether fz is continuous at z equal to 0, or f of z is not continuous at z equal to 0. So let's first of all talk about the limit. So let us choose the first path. Again, you can see that this is not a polynomial function. So we will choose the path as z is, we have to check the limit as z approaches to 0. So we take x approaching to 0 and y approaching to 0. So quickly you can see that when I first take y approaching to 0, y will become 0. So the numerator is becoming 0. So if the numerator becomes 0, whatever is in the denominator, no need to substitute it. You will simply get the answer as 0. Now in the next part, when I approach x approaches to 0 first, when I put x approaches to 0, there was no x in the numerator. There was only x in the denominator term. So we get y square in the denominator. So we get y upon mod y, and mod y can be both plus and minus 1. So my answer will be plus minus 1. So I can see that the limit along these two different paths are not same. So can my answer be the first option? Is the limit existing? No. Can my option be fz is not equal to 0? At fz is equal to 0 only at z equal to 0. So fz is not equal to 0. It is again wrong option. Let's check then for continuity. The next two options are for continuity. So let's check for continuity. So this shows that fz is not continuous because the limit is not only existing, and hence it will not be continuous. You don't have to check for continuous, because for continuity the limit should first exist. So here the limit is only not existing, so it will not be a continuous function, right? Let's look at the second MCQ. In the second MCQ, the function is real part of z square upon mod z square when z is not equal to 0, and it is equal to 0 when z is equal to 0. So again, the options are given here and you need to mark the correct option. So let's look at the solution. Here, the option, okay, let's see what happens. The path is, let's choose the path y approaching to 0 first and then x approaching to 0. When I choose the path y approaching to 0, we get x square upon x square left. So this will cancel and we get 1. When I choose the second path, in the second path, sorry, this should be a real part of z square. This is by mistake I've written imaginary part of z upon mod z. It should be real part of z square upon mod z square. So here when I put x approaching to 0 first, I will get minus y square upon y square. Y square and y square will get cancelled and I get my answer as minus 1, right? And now I can see that the limit along these two paths are different. Along one path it is 1 and along the second path it is minus 1. So the limit will not exist. So if the limit will not exist, that means this cannot be the option. It cannot be continuous. Fz is already equal to 0. It is given to you. And limit of fz is not, it is not existing. And so the option is the last option, that is fz is not continuous at z equal to 0. Right? Okay. Next is differentiability. Now what is differentiability? For differentiability, let's recall the definition of differentiability at a point. A function fz is said to be differentiable at a point z equal to z naught if the following limit exists, right? Which is this limit? We say that f dash z naught is equal to limit h approaching to 0, f of z naught plus h minus f of z naught divided by h. This is the first principle, if you remember the definition in plus 2 that we have done. Now let's see what is the definition of differentiability in complex functions. In complex functions, the definition says that suppose there is a point z naught and I take a neighboring point z naught plus delta z. That means there is a difference of delta z between these two points. So how will I define differentiability? I will find what is the rate of change of this function with respect to these two points. So the rate of change of this function will be f of z naught plus delta z minus f of z naught divided by delta z. and I will take delta z approaching to 0. So this definition, it is the same as we did in the case of real numbers, right? So if this limit value exists, then we say that the function is differentiable and we will term it as f dash at z naught, right? So I have to see what is the rate of change about these two points, about the point and its neighboring point, right? Okay, let's look at an example. You have to find the derivative of fz equal to z square using this principle. So we use the limit definition. We will write that limit delta z approaching to 0. What is f of z plus delta z? It will be z plus delta z whole square minus f of z divided by delta z. So you can just expand this term. When you expand this term, you get z square plus 2z delta z plus delta z whole square minus z square. Z square will get cancelled. And you can take out delta z common from the numerator. It will get cancelled with the denominator. And you will be left with 2z plus delta z. And when I approach delta z approaching to 0, what is the limit value? The limit value is equal to 2z, right? So you can see that using the first principle, we get that derivative of fz is equal to z square. Now, let's look at the second example. For the function fz equal to real part of z, you have to mark the correct option. Whether fz is not continuous, whether fz is continuous but not differentiable, whether fz is differentiable, whether fz is continuous as well as differentiable. That means we have to check for the continuity and differentiability of this particular function. So let's check. Let's check about continuity. Since no point is given, we will assume the point to be z naught. So let us take that z is approaching to z naught. So we find out for continuity, we have to first of all find the limit. So limit z approaches to z naught, f of z is equal to f of z naught. What is f of z naught? We are calling it as real part of z. So real part of z is x. So when I approach z as z naught, what is my z naught? Z naught is x naught plus iota times y naught. That means when z is approaching to z naught, that means x will approach to x naught and y will approach to y naught. So I can write this limit as limit x approaches to x naught, y approaches to y naught, f of z equal to. What will be the value of the limit? You take any path, you will always get the answer as x naught. That means it is continuous, the limit is x naught, and it is also equal to x naught. The function is given to you as x naught. So the limit value is same as the value of the function at that particular point. So it is continuous. Let's see about differentiability. For differentiability, the definition says f dash z is limit delta z approaches to 0, f of z plus delta z minus f of z divided by delta z. Now, what is z plus delta z? F of z was real part of z. So it will be real part of z plus delta z. And what will be real part of z plus delta z? It will be x plus delta x minus f of z. F of z will be x. And what will be delta z? If z is x plus iota y, delta z will be delta x plus iota times delta y. Now I have to check the limit of this function. So again, this is not a polynomial function, so we have to check it pathwise. So delta x approaching to 0, delta y approaching to 0. We first check the first path, delta x approaching to 0 and delta y approaching to 0. So when I put delta x approaching to 0, these two terms will vanish. X minus x will become 0. And I will be left with iota delta y in the denominator. So my answer is 0. And when I check the second path, first delta y approaching to 0 and then delta x approaching to 0. When I put delta y approaching to 0, x and x is already getting cancelled. I'm getting delta x by delta x. So my answer is 1. That means along the two different paths, you're getting two different values of differentiation, right? That is not possible. The derivative is also unique, so you should always get the limit value as a unique number. So you are getting different values and hence the function is not differentiable. That means what is the conclusion? The function was continuous, but it is not differentiable. And hence, what is the correct option? It is the B option, that is FZ is continuous but not differentiable, right? Okay. We move on to the next MCQ. For the function f of z equal to z bar, you have to mark the correct option. Again, the options include continuity and differentiability. So I have solved these two examples. The solutions are given here. You can just go through them once I post you the slides after the lecture is over. And you can see that the function is continuous, but it is not differentiable, because along the two different paths, you will get one of the value is minus one and plus one. So it is not differentiable. Hence, the answer to the MCQ will be it is continuous but not differentiable, right? Likewise, there is one more example exercise for you, which I will be discussing tomorrow in the class, in the beginning of the class. For the function f of z equal to mod z square, you have to mark the correct option. Out of these four, you have to mark the correct option. This is the first exercise. And then this is the second exercise. For the function fz equal to imaginary part of z, this question, so you need to mark the questions. And so these two exercises will be explained to you tomorrow. So till then, you can just solve them. And then we have one more result, that differentiability always implies continuity. This also we have done earlier, right? So here also, complex functions also, differentiability always implies continuity, but continuity does not imply differentiability, right? Okay. Now, any doubts so far? There were some internet problems in between the session. I'm sorry for that. So I couldn't look at your questions. Yes, for continuity, the concept is that you have to first of all find the limit of the function, and then you also have to see what is the value of the function at that particular point. If the limit value is same as the value of the function at that point, only then we will say that the function will be continuous. Otherwise, it will not be continuous, right? Okay. Any other doubt? The last two examples I have left for you. I have just given you the answers there. So it is expected that you go through the examples. And tomorrow you can come 5 minutes early to your class, and then we can just discuss them, right? Okay. So in continuity and differentiability, wherever we have limits, you have to check along the paths. If and only if it is not a polynomial function. If it is a polynomial function, then you can directly substitute the value. But if it is not a polynomial function, then you have to check it pathwise, right? Whether it is differentiability, whether it is continuity, whether it is simple question on limit. So in the context of complex variables, you have numerous paths to check your limit values, right? Okay. The platform for FA will be mailed to you. So don't worry about your platform. So FA platform will be told to you in advance. So don't worry about it. Okay. I will send you these slides, so you can just go through the part of limit, continuity and differentiability. So still, if it is not clear, we can take it up tomorrow, right? Or we can decide some doubt classes and then we can discuss it, right? Okay. Any other doubts regarding any other question? Okay. So I'm just closing the session. If you have any doubts, because once you go through the lecture again, you might face some doubts. If you have any doubts, you're always welcome to drop your queries to tanya.bose@chitkara.edu.in. I will address your doubts there. And you can also ask your subject teachers, whosoever is teaching you in the class. Okay, so we meet tomorrow. Till then, take care.